This is everything you'd ever want to know to get up to
Cut
speed.
it. Cut it. Not sure we're allowed to say that.
I can't?
Yeah.
Are you sure?
Actually, I'm not.
Well, better safe than sorry. My name is Josh White, and I'm gonna break down the Batmobile from Matt Reeves' The Batman. So, stick around.
This quote needs to be shared as a disclaimer. When you watch either this video or the film, make sure that you're going into it with that sense of childlike wonder. This is the Batmobile we're talking about. The Batmobile is always the coalescence between fantasy and reality. This Batmobile might be the most realistic one we've been given. So while there are some things I definitely know about this Batmobile that no one else has either mentioned or collected into one resource, there are some guesses that I needed to wait on a viewing for. And even after the viewing, only a few of those guesses turned into real fact, so I'll try to call out everything as fact, conjecture, or just straight up bat crap. That way you don't have to do it in the comments, and you can just help me out with some of the identification. I reached out to Ash Thorpe, the designer of the Batmobile, but he's locked under NDAs.
Well, due to really gnarly NDAs and all that kind of stuff, I can't say specifically or give any specifics, but yes, I am definitely involved with the design creation of the latest edition of the Batmobile. So
anyway, here's an example of a totally bizarre guess that I'm 95% sure is true. I don't think the rear V8 is doing anything. None of the pulleys are spinning while the Batmobile is in motion, and there doesn't appear to be a tensioner applied to the system anyway. We know that there are 4 mules used in total for filming. A Tesla mule was used for indoor and night scenes, one was used for the rallying scenes with the stunt driver, one was used for interior shots, which had controls taken away from Robert Pattinson, and the final one had a rig on the roof so that a stunt driver could drive it while the cameras were set up in the interior and exterior body panels. With the footage from fans in the London, Paris, Dallas, and Abu Dhabi area, we should be able to figure out which is which. They obviously aren't going to show us the caged mule, but from the bat detective work I could do, the Tesla was delivered for viewing in Paris. The rally kit was delivered to the London Kingsway tram tunnel, which was used as the Batcave entrance near the beginning of the movie, and the interior shots without Pattinson's control was seen at the AT&T Discovery District in Dallas, Texas. There are quite a few differences between these cars. To help with that, I'm going to do an overall breakdown and then a collection of the differences between the EV, the rally car, and the close-up car. Because there are just a lot of things I don't know, I'd love to collect your insights in the comments. If you know more about these parts, then drop a helpful comment below. I'd love to maybe do an ultimate edition of this video later on. If you're okay with me meandering between fact and fiction for a fictional vehicle, hit the like button, subscribe, and let's get on with the video. This is absolutely, without a doubt in my mind, a 1968 to 1970 Dodge Charger body. The Dodge heritage has been confirmed at the Paris showing with the year narrowed down through a comparison of the windows. Many news outlets are seeing a Barracuda in there, and it's a passable assertion, but the B-pillar is too wide an angle, and the Batmobile window better matches the 68 to 70 era of the Charger. Though instead of rolling down, these windows just pop right out in one piece. Underneath the body and the rear-mounted V8 is an all-wheel drive system which is powered by a motor providing somewhere between 650 and 700 brake horsepower, depending on your news source. GQ released an article yesterday, as of this video's release, saying that the vehicle itself uses a 650 brake horsepower Chevrolet V8. But for this statement, they didn't cite either Matt Reeves or James Chinlin, the production designer, who they had available and who would later confirm that the body is a 1969 Dodge Charger. Though they did confess that over 3,000 pieces were machined for the engine alone, so there's definitely the element of recognizability, but I'm 90% sure the engine in the back of the vehicle is a Dodge Hemi. These are the only American V8s that use coil-on plug systems through the valve cover out of the factory. These are also the only coils I've seen that have two hold-down bolts that are on opposite corners for their two spark plugs per cylinder. And further, the only coil plugs that begin at the front of the engine with wires routed toward the rear of the engine. But peep that glow in the front engine bay area. The three exhaust tips and the final tip behind the rear wheel could absolutely be the working 650 brake horsepower Chevrolet V8 that GQ is claiming the Batmobile to have. A lot of early viewers made comments about the intake and it not having one, so here's where disbelief needs suspended a little higher. The engine is backwards, right? In layman's terms, typically a longitudinally mounted engine will have the side with the pulleys toward the front of the vehicle. Even the mid-engine C8 Corvette has their pulleys housed toward the front of the vehicle. In transversely mounted motors, the accessory and pulley side is on the passenger side. This engine is backwards. Intake, usually not always, comes in through the front side of the engine. This is where transversely mounted engines differ. My Volvo XC90 V8 and Ford Probe gets air at the driver's side or backside of the engine. So the intake that is there is just flipped around. Now this intake is tied to two turbos. So no air is going directly into the engine without first going through the turbo. The turbos don't have an air filter though, so all the debris getting sucked through the turbo and the intake is free to combust in the cylinder or wedge its way into a valve gap. But that's only if air and debris can get through those turbos, because for the chase scene, the bulletproof windows are up. But I've said this engine isn't a power providing unit in my intro, and that's true. Not only would it explode, but it's not sustaining. Power isn't being generated by an alternator to sustain spark in the system. And so I'm not staking my life and reputation on identifying this engine as a Hemi. It doesn't work. But there are more things all of the Batmobiles share before I talk about the differences. Let's talk about that supposed power generation. The close-up car gives us a good look at the serpentine belt. I think it's time to retire that term and stick with accessory belt. While it neither routes to the crankshaft pulley nor has a tensioner, it does tell us that this is a Medway D-section V-belt. Medway supplies belts for a wide range of applications in both industrial machinery and agricultural equipment, and isn't rated for passenger vehicle use in that it doesn't conform to SAE standard J1459, even if it conforms to ISO standards for V-belt production. The belt path itself is a deviation from early work, as model maker Jeff Frost's early models show the accessory belt traveling between both cylinder heads. Beyond that, we can see the fuel rails, and at the end, two fuel pressure regulators that heavily mimic Radium Engineering's direct mount pressure regulators, a modification provided when caps were put on the nut knobs. While the ignition coils are seemingly stock, they're covered with a product that is pretty standard in the industry. While searching for opposite corner ignition coils to the valve cover, I came across ECS Tuning's ignition coil hold downs that have a similar view and bolt pattern. These hold downs are bent sheet metal, easily fabricated by the Batcave to debrand the ignition coils. The ignition coils themselves, auto enthusiasts likely already know, command two spark plugs in the same cylinder. So instead of 8 spark plugs for 8 cylinders, this motor has 16 unused spark plugs for the Batmobile's V8. Each of these vehicles sit on 15-inch rims. These wheels are wearing Mickey Thompson Sportsman SR tires. The front tires, sized 30x12x15 at a size on the screen. And the rear are just an inch taller but incredibly wider at the 31x18x15 size, meaning those wheels are 30 inches tall at 12 inches across in the front and 31 inches tall at a whopping 18 inches wide in the back. Interestingly, the tires produced for the rally car are stamped with a 2716 DOT serial number, meaning they were manufactured the first week of July in 2016, the summer after Batman v Superman. So those tires are nearly due for a reboot.
Wait, that's supposed to say due for a refitting. Let me just change that here.
The final commonality I wanted to share before talking about the differences comes from the Batman's gauge cluster. The speedometer, tachometer, and wealth of other gauges were custom manufactured by Speed Hut, popular performance enthusiast gauge makers. However, this JC logo is an Easter egg devoted to the production designer for the movie, James Chinlund.
But wait! There's more!
Let's get into the differences, and sure, let's talk about the EV. We're going to go over braking first. In the electric Batmobile, we have a complete set of Wilwood pedals. These are mounted as the standard swing arm that most consumers would see in their passenger vehicles. Notice that the two left pedals are tied together, creating a double brake pedal for redundancy and security. The pedals themselves are the truss frame pedal arm design, as opposed to the fat T-shaped profile armature. Not only are we redundant there, but if we peek up into the dashboard, we can see the outline of two master cylinders. My best guess? Wilwood's GS compact remote master cylinder with the protective E-coat removed. Though I'll allow myself to be wrong about the branding. Two pedals and two master cylinders is just bonkers to think about. I mean, how heavy is this thing? Comparing to other mules and the movie itself, the electric vehicle is the most different since the movie, and therefore the close-up Batmobile, have floor-mounted pedals. The two left pedals aren't tied together this time, but if we slow down the footage that we have from the dedicated Batmobile trailer, he's slamming into the two pedals with both feet. In their trailer, it's seemingly to accelerate, and since the cut is so short, a matter of milliseconds, they can get away with it. But rest assured, in the movie, he's pressing on the brake pedals in order to slow the vehicle. This electric variant has bigger tanks in the passenger location, and I couldn't hazard a guess as to why, other than maybe covering more cable routing for the Tesla motor's battery pack and battery management system. Not sure. For this last detail, I want to throw a bat signal into the sky for help. I can't find the steering wheel anywhere, and there are a couple design features that lead me down an odd train of thought. First oddity, these spokes flow into the rim, and of course they do on all steering wheels. They need to in order to maintain compliance. The spokes and the rim need to be one unit made of the same material. Often, that material is aluminum or magnesium, but I've rarely seen automotive steering wheels be broken up like that. I've seen that design on boat wheels, though. Schmidt and Ongaro makes a steering wheel that shows what I'm talking about. Going further, the spokes share design features with Isoda's Diama steering wheel, if not for the hub difference, spoke wrap around the rim, and separation of material. Okay, it's pretty obviously different. Why I bring this up is because this is either an OEM wheel or a marine vessel wheel. It's the only thing that makes sense to me. Aftermarket steering wheels are usually cut from sheets of metal or cured fiber and resin. After that, they'll go through a mold and get polyurethane or some other polymer material to flow and expand around the rim. Sometimes it's a wooden rim. But to split a mold into three sections for an aftermarket rim seems like such a high cost for low estimated annual usage.
To rip the sole into seven pieces.
An added oddity, while this steering wheel is a three-bolt attachment, those bolts are not centered around the hub shaft. The lower bolt is proud of the concentric ring by about half an inch. I think we can just chalk this up as another fab job from Batman Incorporated. If you automatically recognize it, kindly leave a comment below, and let's move on to the close-up Batmobile. With this Batmobile, I was able to get a better look at the quick-release product for the steering wheel. This is seemingly the popular Lifeline quick-release with 3-bolt attachment pattern. We can see the same thing on the rally car mule, but using the 6-bolt pattern instead. Since we've already talked about the difference in the pedal system, the last thing I was able to get out of this car is the harness. Batmobile employs a 4-point race harness from Luke Racing Systems. Different from a 5-point harness that divides the legs, Bruce smartly chose the 4-point system while also designing the battering ram as the bumper. You can't design a vehicle that's meant to crash into things while also designing a seatbelt that is meant to crash into your back. And Luke Racing Systems ties right into the seating we see for the rally car. Corbo is the larger motorsports company that supplies aftermarket seating and those Luke harnesses we talked about earlier. In the rally car, we get a definitive look at the seating, which is different from the custom-made on-camera version, but this vehicle was four-fold to long shots anyway. Corbo DFX seats provide higher head support at the mid-price range, but if we're not going to be on camera with it, I might have gone with the Baja XP seats and saved a few bucks. For a multi-million dollar project, I'm sure it didn't matter. And finally, the swapped out OMP 320 carbon steering wheel. Though instead of buying the OMP steering wheel with buttons integrated, they installed their own buttons for what is only labeled as front only and rear only. But since this is one of the ICE vehicles, I'm going to guess that those are for the front headlamps and rear taillights. Y'all, this chase scene went so hard. Of Batmobile chase scenes, this was the most awesome in terms of sound, direction choice, design, color, and power. You want a V8 with whistling turbo? You absolutely got it with a sound department that nails every aspect of the tachometer. You want a Batmobile that can make its way through defensive and offensive maneuvers and still comes home safe? You get it. You want a Batman that can confidently drive at the wheel and not just another Batman who glares in the driver's seat? This stunt driver did a phenomenal job. I can't be more happy about this chase scene. I was grinning from ear to ear both times I've watched it. The shots themselves are tight. Very rarely do we get a full or long shot, and when you do, the Batmobile is bordering that frame, and so there's that tighter sense of claustrophobia. Added to that, this chase takes place to the left and into the screen. I go over movement directions in a whole other video. A quick summary, usually if the good guy is chasing somebody, they're going to the right to progress the timeline of the story. Batman chasing the Penguin to the left does two things. One, it subconsciously imprints in your brain that Batman is the bad guy. That's not the case, obviously, but in the beginning narration, Batman's main objective is to instill fear in those he's after. The fear of him always in the shadows is doing half of the crime-fighting job. Two, it keeps the audience from feeling like there's progress being made. If you tell a story that is progress, 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 but then you swing momentum and start driving the other way, that's going to have an effect on the audience. It's going to reinforce that feeling of tightness, so that when those turbos whine and release, and when the Batmobile shifts gears, it just amplifies that pressure relief. You're opening up an opportunity for the audience to breathe before pinning them right back down in their seat. I can't recommend that you see this in IMAX enough. Matt Reeves and Michael Giacchino didn't have to go that hard for this movie, but they absolutely did.
Now, real fast, if you can't tell, I put a lot of effort into this video, making sure that the research was spot on and that it gave more detail to the movie fans. And I haven't even gotten into the Bat Cycle or his daily driver yet. I don't ask for likes and subscribes a whole lot? Hardly ever. The beginning of this video was the first time that I've done it in a long time, but I did try real hard with this video. So if you could share it with your movie fans or your gearheads, then it would be greatly appreciated. Thanks.
The Batman features three would-be bat cycles. Well, it features two bat bikes, one an inline four-cylinder and the other the four-cylinder boxer engine, but there are parts to a completely different engine in the Batcave. We'll talk about it more in a few minutes, but we're seeing him improve on his bat fleet in the movie's runtime, which is super exciting. One motorbike doesn't work for his needs, so he upgrades. He mixes parts and pieces together a vehicle for the Gotham Project. The motorcycle for the reconnaissance phases of his massless vigilanteism is known simply as the Drifter. A dual overhead camshaft inline four-cylinder is the easiest aspect of the bike to identify. The McFarlane toy for the Drifter provides a better look at the frame, which most closely resembles the Suzuki GS1000, if you look at the frame near the center kickstand area. The flexible boot above the coil housing of the front fork sort of gets thrown around as a red herring, but the front end looks fairly stock. At one point, we see a Kawasaki camshaft holder, or camshaft mount holder, it's hard to give a name to, next to timing chains, springs, and other engine block components laid out in his Batcave. That could be the engine used in filming. The McFarlane toy seems to look like the GS1000 engine with a slightly bigger distance between the crankshaft and the transmission output. But again, it could be another loose red herring. Bruce went from a stripped down, fairly stock Suzuki GS1000 to building out a custom motorcycle for his caped alter ego. With evidence to support it, he's gone through every permutation he could in the little hours of the night in upgrading his bat arsenal. In identifying the bat cycle, something we don't see in his full glory until the very end of the movie, though it's there in use starting in the second act, I'm going to talk about what it most looks like to me, not ever giving a resounding answer since the final product is beyond the limits of designed comfort. Most times I try to identify the vehicles so that enthusiasts could try to mimic their heroes, but since this motorcycle would be wildly uncomfortable, I don't recommend it. The front end does appear to come from the Harley-Davidson Softail Fat Bob. Those forks are nearly a dead ringer in design and fork width, but the air-cooled four-cylinder boxer engine likely came out of either a BMW or Moto Guzzi donor bike. The extraneous trappings of the exhaust manifold don't help. The extended rear swing arm finalizes the hack and assemble nature of the Batman's motorcycle, more so than Catwoman's pretty easily identifiable BMW with a stretched conjecture of an R18 base.
Do it. Call me out in the comments. I gave you the Kawasaki camshaft mount holder with 100% accuracy. You don't think I'm trying my hardest? If you want a Catwoman video, I'll make you a Catwoman video.
Cinematically, it makes sense that Selina Kyle would have merely a slightly modified street bike, whereas Bruce Wayne has the more bespoke Batcycle. A little spoiler, Selina has a small garage with loose motorcycle parts set up in a way to make it believable that the Cat is herself a bike wrencher. And honestly, it fits her character pretty well. Motorcycles provide easy maneuverability through busy city streets, and what could be more perfect for a cat burglar? At the same time, she still needs to modify it to the point of unrecognizability in terms of the standard street cop of Gotham, whereas Bruce is trying to evade the searching eyes of Lieutenant James Gordon. Bruce Wayne, the mask within the mask, has the 1963 two-worded Stingray. This Corvette is outlined countless times by Corvette spotters as the rare rear split window product that only came off the line for 1 year. Broodingly black, Bruce drives this car to the somber scene of the mayor's memorial. I found it incredibly wonderful, the mixture of American and imported products in Batman's garage. The early Batcycles, obviously Japanese influences, maybe a nod to his pre-vigilante training. Using these before sinking deep into that second year of crime fighting and focusing intensely on the plight of his American city, there's no underlying message here, but it left me with a greater impression of loyalty to his city, a city not unlike Detroit in its fall from grace, before it finally started adopting Japanese influences. I'm sure there's a collective rolling of eyes, it just left me to wonder. This is mainly a video concerning the Batmobile, so I let myself be exhaustive in that area's information research. But I wanted to keep these final sections brief, concise, yet information-packed. Hopefully it helped.
Something about this being a Batman who's only in his second year of vigilanteism, needed to piece together his arsenal before refining and refining. Yeah, let's talk about that a little bit.
We've seen a lot of different Batmen. Christian Bale and Christopher Nolan's trilogy provided the most in terms of telling us how Batman was built. Bale's Batman has a few mini missions as he was putting his suit together with Lucius Fox. Bruce relied heavily on Fox to provide the technical support of the Batman team. In this story, Bruce and Alfred are alone, and Bruce is intensely driven by his vengeance.
I'm vengeance.
As a takeaway lesson in life, not going to the extreme of being driven by vengeance, but if you're driven by passion to do something, then the best thing for you to do is just start. You can't wait on Lucius Fox to have a body armor suit that amazingly fits just perfect before you paint it black. You have to work with what you have. Writers, just write. If you don't have a keyboard, use a pencil and paper. Quality engineers, make your micro improvement to your lean assembly line. Make the sales call. Take that first step. If you do, year two might not be as pretty as what Lucius Fox might give you, but it will be intimately yours. You will have created something that belongs to you that you can take extreme ownership for. Yes, it's rote repetition at this point. Batman is piecing together his fleet at this point in his hero journey. Is it the most well-crafted Batmobile that's ever graced the screen? Not a chance. But neither was Iron Man's year two suit of armor. The difference between the two is that Tony is openly heroic, while Bruce has to separate time between the hero and the billionaire. Recognizing that, he's built a Batmobile that works for the mission of the movie. Will we see another variation in the hopefully coming sequels? I can't say. I think that this Batverse has the biggest opportunity to see those improvements on the suit, the cave, and the Batfleet. I'd love to see Ash Thorpe bring a wholly unique new Batmobile to the franchise as the needs of the vigilante changes and he swings from being vengeance to hope. Those are just my hopes, though. Bruce Wayne is in the second year of his Gotham project. Does his garage fit the needs of the billionaire vigilante? The Batmobile? Absolutely. The Batcycle? Room for writing improvement, the Daily Driver, oh yes. Do each of these serve the story and the larger aesthetic of Gotham City? A resounding yes. I can't wait to see what the sequels hold in store for us. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one.